A16, borrowing cost. Another one of the important standard. 17, again, when we discuss more of theory, you know, that doesn't look good after a theory standard. So we thought of taking A16, borrowing cost. Shall we? So this standard prescribes the accounting treatment for borrowing cost. First of all, to know into the standard, we should be knowing basic accounting treatment for borrowing cost. There are two treatments: capitalizing borrowing cost, expensing borrowing cost. It is not classified by AS16. The general accounting treatment for borrowing cost, capitalization and expensing. We have two treatments. One is capitalization, the other one is expensing the borrowing cost. Capitalizing the borrowing cost means what? Borrowing cost added to the cost of the asset. Expensing the borrowing cost means what? Charging to P&L. That way we have two treatments for borrowing cost. So this standard primarily deals with prescribing when borrowing cost will be capitalized and when will be expensed. Understood? So when and all it will be capitalized, and then when and all it will be expense, as well as the quantum of capitalization and quantum amount, quantum of expensing. Understood? So general accounting treatment, capitalization and expensing. Capitalization means addition to the cost of the asset. Expensing means charging to P&L. Shall we?
Yes, sir.
Now, requirement of AS16. That was general classification. Now, requirement of AS16. Because AS16 will not give the equal prominence to both. Now, let me understand AS16 this way. Requirement of AS16. Borrowing costs that are directly attributable to the acquisition, production, construction of a qualifying asset shall be capitalized, else expensed. Understood? Borrowing costs that are directly attributable to the acquisition, production, construction of a qualifying asset shall be capitalized, else it is expensed. Requirement of AS16. Borrowing cost that are directly attributable to the acquisition, production, construction of a qualifying asset shall be capitalized, otherwise expensed. So basic requirement of AS16, it says that. So which means predominantly its main focus will be to tell you when it shall be capitalized, which means it won't give equal prominence telling when and all it will be expensed and all. So when and all it will not be capitalized, it will be expensed. We appreciate that. So that way the discussion is predominantly going to be revolving around when borrowing cost shall be capitalized. Understood? So there are two treatments I told you: expense, capitalization, expensing. Capitalization means addition to the cost of the asset. So when borrowing cost shall be added to cost of the asset is what AS16 going to prescribe. And all of the circumstances, AS16 says that borrowing cost shall be expensed. Please respond.
Yes,
so thereby it is not going to be the expensing part we are going to discuss. It's all about the capitalization part. So to know, to complete the standard is over. You know this statement, the standard is over. But to complete the standard, we should be knowing of three things. No. First, you should know what are borrowing costs. We said borrowing costs should be done this, that and all. But what are borrowing costs you should be knowing? Then qualifying asset and the issues in capitalization. The conditions for capitalization. Understood? So that way we should know what borrowing cost, we should know what are qualifying asset. So we need not be knowing acquisition means what, construction means what, production means what. That are all self-understandable. Could you appreciate that? No definition for that. So borrowing costs that are directly attributable to the acquisition, production, construction of a qualifying asset shall be capitalized. Understood? Otherwise it is expense. Shall we? So first discussion going to be what? Borrowing cost. So when we borrow money, what is that basically you will pay? Commission. Borrowing cost. Borrowing ke primary you pay what? Interest. Understood? Now itself becoming chartered accountant. First commission, you will pay what? Primarily interest. Understanding? So borrowing cost refers to interest cost and includes the following. Borrowing cost refers to interest cost and includes the following, which means it is not merely interest what you think should be taken as borrowing cost. Several other item also should be taken as borrowing cost. So what and all should be taken as borrowing cost? That we are referring when we discuss about the excise duty and other charges. So there are several other components of borrowing cost, I told, correct? So what and all to be considered as borrowing cost? Interest and commitment charges. Interest and commitment charges, incidental cost of borrowings, expenses of borrowings, amortized discount or premium, amortized discount or premium, finance charges arising from finance lease, finance charges arising from finance lease, exchange difference arising from foreign currency loan, exchange difference arising from foreign currency loan to the extent considered as an adjustment to borrowing cost. Exchange difference arising from foreign currency loan to the extent considered as an adjustment to borrowing cost. So these are the various inclusive items. Primarily borrowing cost refers to interest and includes the following. Say suppose the bank has committed a loan of 50 lakhs. So far released only 30 lakhs. They will charge interest only for 30 lakhs. But whereas for the remaining 20 lakhs, they charge a nominal amount, which is called commitment charges. We have incidental cost of borrowing. Other day I was mentioning the point like processing fee, documentation fee, inspection fee, legal fee, surveyor's fee. So like that, so many other expenditures has been incurred in relation to money borrowed. Understood? That will be called as incidental cost of borrowings. It could be like when you issue debentures. Debenture is a type of borrowings. So for debenture related issue expenses, also incidental cost of borrowings. Then amortized discount or premium, again in relation to debentures, bonds or any other debt instruments. It is not only bank borrowing is borrowing, it is any other form of debt is also borrowing. So when you issue debentures, such debentures are issued at discount. So if you are issuing debentures at discount, that discount is also considered as borrowing cost. You should not be having in your P&L as a separate head called miscellaneous expenditure, amortized and all. That should be forming part of borrowing cost as per AS 16. We'll be learning that through AS 30, 31, 32, if it is strictly applied, definitely automatically the discount, premium, everything gets adjusted in borrowing cost. Anyway, so now here, even if it is not adjusted, even if you go for the old accounting method of amortization of discount, discount initially shown in the balance sheet, later on every year some amount gets amortized. Understood? Such discount will be recognized as borrowing cost. Understood? Entire discount we are not recognizing. What you are going to amortize in the current year, charging to P&L, should be arrived only as borrowing cost. So what about premium, sir? How come premium is also borrowing cost? Means premium on redemption. So premium on redemption will be known before, will be booked before also. Such premium on redemption should also be considered as what? Borrowing cost. Could you appreciate that? Are you following this? Everybody, finance charges arising from finance lease. Lease means rental transaction. In rent, various interests, sir. All these things we'll be discussing when we take up AS19. In fact, you know much better about AS19 because it's an IPCC level standard, and we'll be learning in detail also through two and a half sessions time. We'll be learning finance charges or finance lease. That time we'll be discussing something about finance charges. So finance charges arising from finance lease in your P&L should come only as borrowing cost. In your P&L, you may have several items of incomes and expense. Here it should be arising, it should be shown only as borrowing cost. The fifth point is exchange difference arising from foreign currency loan to the extent considered as an adjustment to borrowing cost. Two attempts before there was a question based on this. So again, it can come again also whenever AS16 comes. This is one of the important area of final that it can be asked in the examination. Exchange difference arising from foreign currency loan to the extent considered as an adjustment to borrowing cost. So what is the basis of this AS16? So let us understand this point number 5 in detail, shall we? Other things, there is nothing to be computed. Incidental cost of borrowing means that should be given in the question, correct? Interest commitment charge, amortized discount or premium, finance charge is based on AS19. So we like to focus on this point number 5, which is nothing but exchange difference arising from foreign currency loan to the extent considered as an adjustment to. For this purpose, a bit of AS11, a small bit of AS11 we like to discuss. Understood? What is AS11? The effects of changes in foreign exchange rate. Actually dealing with three parts: accounting for foreign currency transaction, translation, accounting for forward contracts. There are three aspects covered in AS11. One is called accounting for foreign currency transaction. We'll be discussing the same when we take AS11. That time you should only recap. There are three things. One is accounting for foreign currency transaction. The other one is translation. The other one is forward contracts. Everybody. Okay, in this first part, accounting for foreign currency transaction. When an enterprise makes one or two transactions in foreign currency, predominantly it is having one reporting currency, correct? An Indian enterprise making all the transactions in rupees, one or two transactions in foreign currency, maybe making a particular sales or maybe a single purchases or taking a loan from a foreign country, maybe one or two transactions in foreign currency. Everybody. So that time we will be following the accounting for foreign currency transaction rules. According to accounting also, what is involved is not real accounting. There also it is only translation. There also what is involved is only translation. What sort of translation? Say suppose I took a loan as $1 lakh. How much? $1 lakh. In my books I can't show cash to loan $1 lakh, correct? I'll be expressing in rupees. Even if I've taken the loan, I utilize in loan form only. In fact, even if I take a loan in the form of dollar loan, correct? And I used only dollars, but still I have to record in rupees as well as application also in rupees, correct? Everybody, I can't record. Suppose dollar received $1 lakh and use $1 lakh for settlement of a party, I can't record in my books as $1 lakh. Could you appreciate that? I have to convert into rupees. Everybody. So thereby there were certain issues that in discussing about accounting for foreign currency transaction. Very quickly I will tell you, in detail I will tell you at the time of taking AS. Transaction we will record at the rate prevailing on the date of transaction. Yes, sir. Transaction will be recorded at the rate prevailing on the date of transaction. Okay. Then every year balance sheet, monetary items if any, shall be restated to the balance sheet rate. Every year balance sheet, what items? Monetary item shall be restated to the balance sheet rate. What is monetary item? Then the question arises, what are monetary items? Monetary item refers to money held, first of all. What item? Money held. Cash in hand, cash at bank. No. Money held. Cash in hand, cash at bank. And other assets and liabilities expressed in fixed denomination of receivables and payables. And other assets and liability expressed in ఫిక్స్డ్ డినామినేషన్ ఆఫ్ రిసీవబుల్స్ అండ్ సరే ఎస్ఎన్స్ అలోన్ విల్ టేక్ ద కోర్ పార్ట్ ఇన్ ఏఎస్ 11 అండర్స్టూడ్ మానిటరీ ఐటమ్ యూజువలీ రెఫర్స్ టు రిసీవబుల్స్ అండ్ మానిటరీ ఐటమ్స్ రెఫర్స్ టు రిసీవబుల్స్ అండ్ పేయబుల్స్ ఎవ్రీబాడీ సచ్ మానిటరీ ఐటమ్ షాల్ బి రీస్టేటెడ్ టు ద బ్యాలెన్స్ షీట్ సో $1 lakh లోన్ కరెక్టా రెస్పాండ్ సో అట్ దట్ టైమ్ ఎక్స్చేంజ్ రేట్ వాస్ 50 rupees హౌ మచ్ సో హౌ మచ్ లోన్ 50 lakhs క్యాష్ టు లోన్ ఆర్ బ్యాంక్ టు లోన్ హౌ మచ్ 50 lakhs ఎవ్రీబడి నౌ అట్ ది ఎండ్ ఆఫ్ ది ఇయర్ ఐఎమ్ నాట్ రీపేయింగ్ లోన్ బట్ ఎక్స్చేంజ్ రేట్ కేమ్ టు 52 rupees ఎక్స్చేంజ్ రేట్ కేమ్ టు ఈవెన్ దో ఐఎమ్ నాట్ రీపేయింగ్ లోన్ ఐ హ్యావ్ టు రీస్టేట్ ద లోన్ ఐ హ్యావ్ టు షో ద లోన్ యాజ్ హౌ మచ్ I didn't get extra 2 lakhs, but loan just became 52 lakhs. Interest anyway, I'm paying separately. It is not interest getting added to 50 lakhs. Could you appreciate that? Interest was paid. In spite of interest paid, loan is increasing. Why loan is increasing? Because of exchange rate fluctuation. Could you appreciate that? Respond. So you are restating the loan. Whatever difference arising at that time is regarded as exchange gain or loss and will be recognized in the statement of P&L. Will be recognized as? Exchange gain or loss and will be recognized in the statement of P&L as exchange gain or loss will be recognized in the P&L as now AS 16 interferes and says that some portion of exchange loss to be accounted as borrowing cost some portion of exchange loss to be accounted as So, first AS 11 says any difference is exchange gain or loss as per AS 11 and should be charged in P&L. Respond. Okay. Now, AS 16 coming and saying that no. Some portion of exchange loss in relation to foreign currency loan. I am not going to interfere in debtors and creditors. In case of foreign currency loan, some portion of exchange loss to be considered as an adjustment to borrowing cost. We will book it only as borrowing cost, not as exchange loss. Now, presently, we are not discussing about whether it will be capitalized or expensed. Even after treating it as borrowing cost, still it will go to P&L. Now, the fight is between, is it exchange loss or borrowing cost? Understood? Not the fight between, is it going to P&L or balance sheet? Are you following? So, please understand, we are not discussing about, should it be capitalized or should it be expensed? We are actually discussing, is it to be booked as per AS? 11 or is it to be booked as per AS 16 understood in that first prayer now fight is there AS 11 says what any x differences will be booked as exchange gain or loss understanding AS 16 says what some portion of loss should be treated as now fight between AS 11 and AS 16 correct now who will have the greatest to say which standard will be given priority in AS 16 understood so the standard set as give priority to So some portion of AS exchange loss, first when there is a fight between AS 11 and AS 16, standard setter says that, stop the dispute, first AS 16 come and take your share and AS 16 will take the share, understood, respond. After AS 16 take the share, balance whatever left will be accounted as per AS 11. This is obvious, setting this, solving the problem, understood. So how much will be recognized as per AS 16 is what we like to discuss. Understood? Now the link is provided, but then again monetary all this in detail we'll discuss when we take up AS 11. Could you appreciate that? So AS 11 says any exchange differences when you take that should be booked as exchange gain or loss. AS 11 says fully to be booked as exchange, but AS 16 says that some portion should be treated as not entire amount. That is the point. Suppose any exchange loss arising from foreign currency loan to be taken as AS 16, then there is no fight. Respond. It is not the entire exchange loss to be booked as borrowing cost, only a portion. Understood? How much is what we are discussing? Shall we proceed? So, exchange difference arising from foreign currency loan to the extent considered as an adjustment to borrowing cost is what we are going to work out. Shall we? Imagine the date of loan. Let me give you some numbers and then I will bring out the quantum. Understood? The provision relating to the quantum of adjustment will bring out later. After let me giving you some numbers here. Date of loan. 1/4/2013 amount. $1,00,000. Everybody? Okay. Exchange rate. Say it is rupees 50. On that date, exchange rate was rupees 50. What is the loan amount you will recognize? 50 lakhs. Everybody? Okay. Interest. Interest, it is 9%. Interest, it is 9%. Understood? So what is the 9% interest means? $9,000. Understood? So you should not misunderstand any other way. It is only $9,000. Everybody? Okay. Now, interest in dollar, it was 9%. Interest in rupees was 12%. Everybody, interest in rupees was 12%. And in interest in dollars, 9%. Which means what, sir? So am I paying interest to both the places? No. Had you borrowed in rupees at that time, interest would have been 12%. Which means you would have paid how much interest? 50 lakhs into 12%. 6 lakhs. Respond. And if the exchange rate is not changing, how much interest actually you are paying? 4 lakh? Exchange rate, that is 9% on $1,00,000, $9,000 into rupees 50. How much is that? 4,50,000. So you are going to get a savings in interest of 1,50,000. A big gain. Correct? By not taking loan in rupees and taking loan in foreign currency, dollar, we are going to get a savings in interest to the extent of 1,50,000. This is what they are foreseeing, and they thought that there is gain of 1,50,000. Correct? Could you appreciate that? If there was no exchange differences, if it is going to be the same, definitely we are going to have a huge savings in interest. Because had we borrowed, I want actually 50 lakhs. I could have borrowed in our country where interest rate is 12%. I was just taking my option of international level where I have a very good credit rating. I find it is only 9% in dollars, and thereby it took $1,00,000. Is that clear? Okay, now listen. Now, by 31st March 2014, exchange rate is $1 equal to rupees 54. Everybody, on 31st March 2014, exchange rate $1 equal to rupees 54. Understood? Respond. Yes, sir. Okay. Now what happens when the $1 equal to 54? How much interest you will pay? How much interest you will pay? Don't bring out any computation. How much interest you will pay? $9,000 you should have lesser. So how much interest you will pay? $9,000 is the computation, ba. On that date, you don't have dollars, my dear. So how much amount you will pay? 4,86,000. To have $9,000, you should have rupees, na? That's a question. So how much interest you will pay? Okay. The real form of payment is $9,000, but out of your packet, how much will go out? 4 lakh and. Because $9,000 now will cost each dollar how much? 54. So how much interest you are going to pay? So actual interest that you are going to pay is $9,000 into rupees 54. How much is that? Please respond. 4,86,000. 4,86,000. Everybody? This is borrowing cost. Anyway, this is not anyway having special impact by point number 5. This is anyway basic interest cost, and thereby this is borrowing cost. Correct? Yes, sir. Now our discussion is loan principal going to be restated. Loan principal going to be restated. Correct? The loan was recognized as how much loan? On the date of taking loan, loan taken is $1 lakh was recognized in the books as how much? 50 lakhs. Now at the end of the year, 31st March 2014, you will restate the loan as how much? 54 lakhs. You will increase the loan by? This is called exchange difference. And naturally to be booked as exchange loss. If it was any other monetary item, it is just directly entry exchange loss to loan. Exchange loss to loan. Exchange loss 4 lakhs to loan. And exchange loss will be transferred to P&L. But because of AS16 interference, saying that some portion of this 4 lakhs to be treated as borrowing cost. The balance of the 4 lakhs should be treated as exchange loss. Are you following? So first we are identifying the exchange difference. What is the exchange difference? 4 lakhs. Now out of 4 lakhs, a portion will be accounted as? Other how much? It is very simple. It is to the extent of difference between interest in reporting currency and the interest in foreign currency. What is the amount to be adjusted against borrowing cost? It is the amount of difference between adjustment to borrowing cost will be difference between interest in reporting currency based on the assumption that if loan was taken in reporting currency. Why I am making this point now? Which interest rate I should consider? Interest rate prevailing on 31st March 2014 or interest rate prevailing on 1/4/2013? So interest rate prevailing on 1/4/2013. That is what we are telling. So we'll make an assumption. Had the loan was taken on 1/4/2013 in reporting currency, what interest you would have paid? That is what we are considering. Could you appreciate that? Because today if you want to take loan, today means what? 31st March 2014. Today it may be 13% or 11%. That interest you should not consider. On the date of the actual date of loan, you took foreign currency loan. On what date? 1st April 2000. On the date, had you borrowed in rupees, how much would have been the interest rate? That interest you should consider. Correct? So difference between that interest and interest in foreign currency. So interest in reporting currency and interest in foreign currency. So in this example, how to compute that? Very simple. We just find out that it is 50 lakhs into 12%. Can you turn this page? Can you turn this page?
Yes, sir.
First, exchange difference. Exchange difference arising from foreign currency loan. What is that? $1 lakh into 54 minus 50. How much is that? Rupees 4 lakhs. Correct? Please respond. 50 rupees to be restated as 54. There is an exchange difference of 4 lakhs. Out of this 4 lakhs, the question is how much to be accounted as per AS and how much will be booked as AS 11. Here it is balancing figure. So priority is for AS 16. So it is nothing but the difference between interest in rupees. How much? 6 lakhs. Which is 50 lakhs into 12%. What is 50 lakhs? 1 lakh into 50 rupees. That the dollar into exchange rate prevailing on the date of taking loan. Now into 12%, 6 lakhs. Then interest in dollars, 4,86,000. 1,14,000. Everybody, so out of 4 lakhs, 1,14,000 will be accounted as what? Borrowing cost. Understood? Out of 4 lakhs, 1,16,000 will, 1,14,000 will be accounted as borrowing cost, which means exchange loss. 2,86,000 balancing figure. This is called adjustment to borrowing cost. What do you mean by adjustment to borrowing cost? It's an addition to the borrowing cost. Understood? Which means, why we say adjustment to borrowing cost? So, can you tell me what is the total borrowing cost to be recognized for the year 13-14? From this loan, what is the total borrowing cost shall be recognized in the year 13-14? It is 6 lakhs. That is the point you should be knowing. Actual interest cost of 4,86,000 plus adjustment to borrowing cost of 1,14,000. That way total borrowing cost will be how much? 6 lakhs rupees. Understood? And how much your exchange loss? 2,86,000. And 2,86,000 will be booked as per AS. How much is the total borrowing cost? 6 lakhs. Adjustment to borrowing cost? 1,14,000. 4,86,000 anyway borrowing cost. Correct? That is called the normal interest. Everybody, that nobody is going to fight between AS16 and AS7. This is normal basic interest. Then out of exchange loss, some portion will be considered as borrowing cost. How much? That is what we are discussing. Exchange difference arising from foreign currency loan to the extent considered as an adjustment to the borrowing cost. So what sort of adjustment you will make? Now the difference between interest in reporting currency and the interest in reporting currency had the loan was taken in reporting currency. Are you following? Everybody. So now can you tell me, if you understood the provision, the provision is over. If you understood the provision, can you tell me the answer for this AS16 and AS11 breakup if the exchange rate is 55? Technically we should be in a position to tell if the exchange rate is 55, what do you think the answer? 1,05,000. What is adjustment and what is 1,05,000 and 3,95,000. So if it is 55 means what happened? It is 1 lakh into 5 rupees. So it is 5 lakhs rupees is exchange difference. In that, what is as per AS16? Interest in rupees. That is not going to change. It will be 6 lakhs. Interest in dollar will have a slight change. Correct? $9,000 remains the same into 55. 4,95,000. So it will be 1,05,000. Everybody. And as per AS11, how much is that? 3,95,000. It, because it is out of 5 lakhs, this is adjustment to borrowing cost and this is exchange loss as per AS11. Could you appreciate that? Everybody, so tell me what is the total borrowing cost? 6 lakhs. Adjustment to borrowing cost? AS11 adjustment? 3,95,000. Understood? Everybody, super. So can you tell me the answer for 52 rupees? Exchange rate 52. This is answer for if exchange rate is $1 equal to 55. I want the answer for 52. 132 and Everybody? So again, this will be 60 lakhs, huh? 9,000 into 52. How much is that? 4 lakh? 68. So it is 1 lakh? 32. 2 lakhs, 2 lakhs minus? So this is 68. So everybody? Pakka? Okay, last term. 51. Huh? Oh, loan amount is increasing his exchange gain, huh? Okay. Fine. So we find 1 lakh into rupee 1. That is 51 minus 50. Correct? 1 lakh rupee. Everybody?
Yes, sir.
Exchange loss totally how much? 1 lakh. As per AS16, we find interest in rupees, same 60 lakhs. I said 6 lakhs. ரொம்ப டைம் ஆகும். இன்ட்ரெஸ்ட் இன் டாலர்ஸ் 9,000 இன்டூ 51. 4,50,000. டிஃபரன்சஸ் வாட் இஸ் இட் ஆக்சுவலி வி ஆர் டிஸ்கசிங் அவுட் ஆஃப் த எக்ஸ்சேஞ்ச் லாஸ் ஹவு மச் ஷுட் பி ட்ரீட்டட் அஸ் பாரோயிங் காஸ்ட். ஆர் ஐ ஃபாலோவிங்? ஃபர்ஸ்ட் ப்ரையாரிட்டிஸ் ஃபார் AS16, understood? When the exchange loss itself is only 1 lakh, then maximum 1 lakh can only be adjusted as borrowing cost.
Yes,
you can't adjust 1,41,000. They never say that 141 mandatory to be adjusted as borrowing cost. The discussion is actually about treatment of exchange difference in adjustment to borrowing cost. Could you appreciate that? So first of all, what is available for adjustment is only how much? 1 lakh. You may require 141. So we asked you, first you take your share. AS16 will take their share, correct? So in all other cases, AS16 took their share, balance was given to AS11. Now AS16 came with a plan that we want to take 1,41,000. Available is 1 lakh, now they can take only how much? So how much is the adjustment to borrowing cost? 1 lakh. And exchange loss as per AS11 is nil. There is no exchange gain and all. Are you following? No, as per AS16 mandatory, you should give this much. And balance will be treated as exchange gain. There is no such concept. Everybody? So we are discussing treatment of exchange difference. So to what extent will be adjusted as borrowing cost? And means, so thereby finally we are just making out a provision. So let us bring out the provision. What is the provision? Income tax like provision we can create. What is that? Adjustment to borrowing cost will be the difference between interest in reporting currency and interest in foreign currency, or the amount of exchange difference, whichever is less. Understood? We can create a provision. Like the provision is not there, we should be applying our provision saying that it is restricted to 1 lakh, but we can create a provision. What is the provision we can create? The amount of adjustment will be the difference between interest in reporting currency and the interest in foreign currency, or the amount of exchange difference, whichever is less. That amount only can be considered as adjustment. Understood? In this case, 1,41,000 is the difference. But exchange difference is only?
1 lakh.
So 1 lakh or 1,41,000, whichever is less. This is what you should be knowing. Everybody? Okay. So in this case, what is the adjustment to borrowing cost?
1 lakh.
1 lakh. What is the total borrowing cost?
6 lakh.
What? Total borrowing cost is only 5,59,000. In this case, total borrowing cost is not 6 lakhs, total borrowing cost is only? Because actual interest was how much? Actual interest, 4,59,000, and adjustment to borrowing cost, 1 lakh, and that way total borrowing cost is only 5,59,000, and exchange loss as per AS11, nil. Understood? This is the impact of point number 5. We have just now defined what are borrowing costs. We are discussing which standard? A16 actually provides the accounting treatment for? There are two treatments. One is capitalizing the borrowing cost, other one is expensing the borrowing cost. And we told initially the basic requirement of borrowing cost. What is the basic requirement? Borrowing costs that are directly attributable to the acquisition, production, construction of a qualifying asset shall be capitalized. And we discussed what are borrowing costs. Adala specifica, an issue in relation to the exchange difference, which is having a link to AS11 and understood. Those companies who adopt para 46A of AS11, which is a newly inserted paragraph in AS11, for them this provision is not applicable. Understood? Fight between AS11 and AS16, which will prevail?
AS16.
But fight between AS16 and paragraph 46A of AS11, amended paragraph, means that will prevail. Are you following? It was actually a notification given by the central government, later on inserted in AS11. So, and that paragraph is applicable only for companies. Anyway, that we will link when we take up AS11. Understood? Everybody, now coming back to this issue, so thereby you understand exchange difference, some portion will be adjusted against the borrowing cost. It is nothing but the difference between interest in reporting currency and the interest in foreign currency. Understood? Interest in reporting currency and interest in foreign currency, or amount of exchange difference, whichever is less. Now, next part, qualifying asset. So we're discussing qualifying asset. So please understand. Imagine, say I took a loan for 10 lakhs. I took a loan for, I'm purchasing one car for 10 lakhs. After taking a loan for 10 lakhs, I'm purchasing a car for 10 lakhs because I find that this is the right time to buy car. So lots of duties and all cut for cars. So thereby we are buying a car, correct? Okay. So for 1 year, I'm not using the car. Simply kept idle at home. Everybody, for 1 year, if I'm more than 1 year, 1 year and 3 months, the car is still not used. Everybody. And I have paid interest for this loan. Everybody. The interest paid on such loan, can we add that to the cost of the car? So far I have not used. It is more than 12 months. So interest which I have paid on the car, that is not car, on the loan, can that be added to the cost of the car? When the loan is exclusively for this particular car, can I add this interest? No. Because car is not a qualifying asset. Understood? Appo, first of all, to capitalize interest, the asset should be? It is not merely relation. So the interest is relating to asset. I understand that. I know it. But the asset is not qualifying asset. So merely the interest is relating to asset is not sufficient. The asset should be? So what are qualifying asset? An asset that takes substantial period of time for its intended use. An asset that takes substantial period of time for its intended use is what we call it as qualifying asset. An asset that takes substantial period of time for its intended use is what we call it as qualifying asset. Understood? Which means, when I bought the car was ready for use. I didn't use the car. Understood? So I don't know driving. Understood? So 4% tax cut, so FM announced it, and thereby directly I bought the car. Since I don't know the driving, I am not using the car for 15 months. Understood? Everybody. So in that case, in fact that happened for 6 months in my life, so not 15 months. So when we find that when the car was not utilized, but still the car is a asset which is ready for use, so thereby car is not a qualifying asset. Could you appreciate that? So an asset that is ready for use now, then it is not a qualifying asset. An asset that takes substantial period of time for its intended use, then it is a qualifying asset. Could you appreciate that? Everybody? See, it is not like this asset is qualifying asset, this asset is not qualifying asset. Suppose example, I bought this car. Everybody, I bought this car for how much? By taking a? For 15 months I didn't use the car. Why I didn't use the car means, I want to modify the car to be used as a race car. My objective to use the car is not for simply using, I want to use it as a? So similarly we find that I would like to use this car as a race car. It will take around 15-18 months time for remodification and lots of trial run has to be made. It has to be run, test drive should be made, lots of things should be done onto the car. Understood? Everybody, in that case, the interest paid on that loan, can I capitalize to the car?
Yes.
Yes. So it's not that this asset is qualifying, this asset is not qualifying. It's all about, this is very, very important. Intended use. Not merely ready for use, it should be ready for intended use. So an asset that takes substantial period of time, an asset that takes substantial period of time for its intended use is what we call it as qualifying asset. Could you appreciate that? So which means an asset which is ready for intended use means we buy truck, we buy ready for use, not a qualifying asset. No, not ready. We have to make lots of modification. Generally, most of the companies buy trucks without any super construction. With free only, so that they will construct to their requirements. Understood? In that case, a truck will be a qualifying asset. If the truck is ready for use, means it is not a qualifying asset. Understood? So no assets can be called categorically as this is qualifying and this is not qualifying. It's all depending upon? But that alone not sufficient. It also question of substantial period of time. Understood? An asset that takes substantial period of time for its intended use. So what is that substantial period of time? Any period. Substantial period of time could be any period as justified. Understood? Everybody, can we say 2 months a substantial period? Yes. Can we say 3 months a substantial period? Yes. 7 months, any period can be substantial period. Understood? But the institute provides a guideline saying that generally a period of 12 months can be considered as substantial period unless otherwise justified. Understood? Which means you can justify saying 3 months as substantial period. So standard is not so rigid in saying that this is what substantial period. Could you appreciate this? What is it actually we are discussing? Out of the exchange loss, how much should be treated as borrowing costs? Are you following? First priority is for AS16. Understood? When the exchange loss itself is only 1 lakh, then maximum 1 lakh can only be adjusted as borrowing cost. You can't adjust 1,41,000. They never say that 1,41,000 mandatory to be adjusted as borrowing cost. The discussion is actually about treatment of exchange difference in adjustment to borrowing cost. Could you appreciate that? So first of all, what is available for adjustment is only how much? 1 lakh. You may require 1,41,000. So we asked you, first you take your share. AS16 will take their share, correct? So in all other cases, AS16 took their share, balance was given to AS11. Now AS16 came with a plan that we want to take 1,41,000. Available is 1 lakh now. They can take only how much? So how much is the adjustment to borrowing cost? 1 lakh. And exchange loss as per AS11 is nil. There is no exchange gain and all. Are you following? No. As per AS16 mandatory, you should give this much. And balance will be treated as exchange gain. There is no such concept. Everybody? So we are discussing treatment of exchange difference. So to what extent will be adjusted as borrowing cost? And means, so thereby finally we are just making out a provision. So let us bring out the provision. What is the provision? Income tax like provision we can create. What is that? Adjustment to borrowing cost will be the difference between interest in reporting currency and interest in foreign currency or the amount of exchange difference, whichever is less. Understood? We can create a provision. Like the provision is not there, we should be applying our provision saying that it is restricted to 1 lakh, but we can create a provision. What is the provision we can create? The amount of adjustment will be the difference between interest in reporting currency and the interest in foreign currency or the amount of exchange difference, whichever is less. That amount only can be considered as adjustment. Understood? In this case, 1,41,000 is the difference. But exchange difference is only? So 1 lakh or 1,41,000, whichever is less. This is what you should be knowing. Everybody? Okay, so in this case, what is the adjustment to borrowing cost?
1 lakh.
1 lakh. What is the total borrowing cost? What? Total borrowing cost is only 5,59,000. In this case, total borrowing cost is not 6 lakhs, total borrowing cost is only? Because actual interest was how much? Actual interest, 4,59,000, and adjustment to borrowing cost, 1 lakh, and that way total borrowing cost is only 5,59,000, and exchange loss as per AS 11?
Nil.
Understood? This is the impact of point number 5. We have just now defined what are borrowing costs. We are discussing which standard?
AS 16
actually provides the accounting treatment for? There are two treatments. One is capitalizing the borrowing cost, other one is expensing the borrowing cost. And we told initially the basic requirement of borrowing cost. What is the basic requirement? Borrowing costs that are directly attributable to the acquisition, production, construction of a qualifying asset shall be capitalized. And we discussed what are borrowing cost. Other specific, an issue in relation to the exchange difference, which is having a link to AS 11 and
AS.
Understood? Those companies who adopt para 46A of AS 11, which is a newly inserted paragraph in AS 11, for them, these provisions not applicable. Understood? Fight between AS 11 and AS 16, which will prevail? But fight between AS 16 and paragraph 46A of AS 11 amended paragraph means that will prevail. Are you following? It was actually a notification given by the central government, later on inserted in AS 11. So, and that paragraph is applicable only for companies. Anyway, that we will link when we take up AS 11. Understood? Everybody, now coming back to this issue, so thereby you understand exchange difference, some portion will be adjusted against the borrowing cost. It is nothing but the difference between interest in reporting currency and the interest in foreign currency. Understood? Interest in reporting currency and interest in foreign currency, or amount of exchange difference, whichever is less. Now, next part, qualifying asset. So we're discussing qualifying asset. So please understand. Imagine, say I took a loan for 10 lakhs. I'm purchasing a car for 10 lakhs. After taking a loan for 10 lakhs, I'm purchasing a car for 10 lakhs because I find that this is the right time to buy car. So lots of duties and all cut for cars. So thereby we are buying a car, correct? Okay. So for 1 year, I'm not using the car. Simply kept idle at home. Everybody, for 1 year, if I'm more than 1 year, 1 year and 3 months, the car is still not used. Everybody. And I have paid interest for this loan. Everybody. The interest paid on such loan, can we add that to the cost of the car? So far I have not used. It is more than 12 months. So interest which I have paid on the car, that is not car, on the loan, can that be added to the cost of the car? When the loan is exclusively for this particular car, can I add this interest? No. Because car is not a qualifying asset. Understood? Apo, first of all, to capitalize interest, the asset should be? It is not merely relation. So the interest is relating to asset. I understand that. I know it. But the asset is not qualifying asset. So merely the interest is relating to asset is not sufficient. The asset should be? So what are qualifying asset? An asset that takes substantial period of time for its intended use. An asset that takes su- substantial period of time. For its intended use is what we call it as qualifying asset. An asset that takes substantial period of time for its intended use is what we call it as qualifying asset. Understood? Which means when I bought the car was ready for use. I didn't use the car. Understood? So I don't know driving. Understood? So 4% tax cut, so PM, FM announced it, and thereby directly I bought the car. Since I don't know the driving, I am not using the car for 15 months. Understood? Everybody. So in that case, in fact that happened for 6 months in my life, so not 15 months. So when we find that when the car was not utilized, but still the car is a asset which is ready for use. So thereby car is not a qualifying asset. Could you appreciate that? So an asset that is ready for use now, then it is not a qualifying asset. Asset that takes substantial period of time for its intended use, then it is a qualifying asset. Could you appreciate that? Everybody? See, it is not like this asset is qualifying asset, this asset is not qualifying asset. Suppose example, I bought this car. Everybody? I bought this car for how much? By taking a? For 15 months I didn't use the car. Why I didn't use the car means I want to modify the car to be used as a race car. My objective to use the car is not for simply using, I want to use it as a race car. So many celebrities have the hobby as racing. I also would like to have race as my hobby, and I would like to use the car as race car. Understood? So many talawal and all is there, using for hobby, all this purpose. So similarly we find that I would like to use this car as a race car. It will take around 15-18 months time for remodification, and lots of trial run has to be made, it has to be run, test drive should be made, lots of things should be done onto the car. Understood? Everybody? In that case, the interest paid on that loan, can I capitalize to the car?
Yes.
So it's not that this asset is qualifying, this asset is not qualifying. It's all about, this is very, very important. Intended use. Not merely ready for use, it should be ready for intended use. So an asset that takes substantial period of time. An asset that takes substantial period of time for its intended use is what we call it as qualifying asset. Could you appreciate that? So which means an asset which is ready for intended use means we buy truck. We buy ready for use, not a qualifying asset. No, not ready. We have to make lots of modification. Generally, most of the companies buy trucks without any super construction. With free only, so that they will construct to their requirements. Understood? In that case, a truck will be a qualifying asset. If the truck is ready for use, means it is not a qualifying asset. Understood? So no assets can be called categorically as this is qualifying and this is not qualifying. It's all depending upon, but that alone not sufficient. It also question of substantial period of time. Understood? And I said that takes substantial period of time for its intended use. So what is that substantial period of time? Any period. Substantial period of time could be any period as justified. Understood? Everybody? Can we say 2 months a substantial period?
Yes.
Can we say 3 months a substantial period? Yes. 7 months, any period can be substantial period. Understood? But the institute provides a guideline saying that generally a period of 12 months can be considered as substantial period unless otherwise justified. Understood? Which means you can justify saying 3 months as substantial period. So standard is not so rigid in saying that this is what substantial period. Could you appreciate that? Everybody? A student may come and ask me, sir, how long I should study for passing CA? Understood? So that is depending upon. There are students who I've seen that students studying only for 1 month and just somehow get through this CA. There are students who are studying for 2 years plan, target mission CA final, 2 years day and night studying and still not clearing. Understood? Say anything is possible. Understood? So we can't define what is substantial period. Your substantial period need not be the substantial period for another person. So like that, business also differ based on the nature, size, everything. Understood? So what is substantial period? It will differ from enterprise to enterprise. Everybody? Now here, institute is giving a guideline saying 12 months period can be taken as? Usually there is a customary period of education that usually 3 months only you should put efforts very rigorously for passing CA. Most conventionally I am telling, because the last from very very olden time onwards, an articleship generally asks leave for 3 months. Maybe some of them are asking 4 months, 2 months and all. Normally it is a span of 3 months is what is asked. Understood? Doesn't mean that that is a rule. Do you appreciate that? Please respond. Anyway, coming back to this issue, qualifying asset means an asset that takes, and what is substantial period of time? Any period can be justified as substantial period, but normally a period of 12 months will be considered as substantial period of time. Do you appreciate that? Everybody, now listen carefully. Say we take a loan for 50 lakhs. Loan amount how much? 50 lakhs. In this, we spend 15 lakhs for acquisition of land to be used for construction of a building. And we already spent 25 lakhs in construction. Still 10 more lakhs to be incurred. Construction the halfway. Understood? Now we took a loan for 50 lakhs. Actually, primary intention to construct a building to be used as an office premise. Everybody. Now in that already first spend 15. Then we spend 25. Everything happened in the same year only. Understood? And we have paid interest. We have paid interest on 50 lakhs. We have paid interest on 50 lakhs. Everybody. So 50 lakhs into 10% is the interest that we have paid, and the interest came to 5 lakhs. Interest actually came to 5 lakhs. Understood? No talking. Listen, please. How much interest can be capitalized? The interest in relation to how much? 50 lakhs can be capitalized? No, only to the amount spent. Respond. Thereby you can capitalize interest only up to 2.5 lakhs. Because land is not a qualifying asset. Because land is ready for use that moment you purchased. Sir, what, for what purpose the land was purchased? To construct building. Land was ready for construction by the time you purchased. So land is not a first 10 lakhs you cannot capitalize because that was not spent. Please respond. You cannot capitalize for 15 lakhs because you are spent on an asset which is not a qualifying asset. Understood? Please respond. Bah. Sir, please understand. Land is not a. Why? Sir, land is ready for the intended use. What was the intended use? Construct the building. Understood? And land was ready for construction thereby. But it was, if it was inseparable, sir, we are acquiring land and building together. Understood? Inseparable, then it may be considered as qualifying asset. But if you pay separately money for land, then the land is not a qualifying asset. Suppose we acquired this land. We acquired this land and we want to use the land. We want to use this particular land to use as a golf course. Understood? I want to convert this land to be used as a golf course. Understood? I want to use the land like that only. No constructions and all will be made. The land only will be cleaned and so many modifications will be made to the land. I want to use the land as a golf course. In that land is a qualifying asset. Because no construction. After remodifying golf course also, I want to call this land and building and all. It is still land only. Understood? No extra asset is added there. Understood? Please respond, Bob. So thereby land is a qualifying asset. So the point which I want to do through various examples is that never like this asset is always qualifying asset, this asset is not qualifying asset. It's all about intended use. Could you appreciate that? So land for building construction was not a land to be used as a golf course is a qualifying asset. Could you appreciate that? So what are qualifying asset? An asset that takes substantial period of time for its intended use is what we call it as qualifying asset. Everybody understood? Okay, so next. So we understood about qualifying asset. We understood what are borrowing costs. Respond. We understood what are borrowing costs. We also understood what are qualifying asset. Now we like to discuss about the issues in capitalization. Right? So we have capitalization. In capitalization, AC போட சொல்லுங்க சரி இந்த 5 மினிட்ஸ்ல போட்டுலாம் கேபிட்டலைசேஷன் 3 ஆஸ்பெக்ட்ஸ் ஆஃப் கேபிட்டலைசேஷன் வி ஆர் லேர்னிங் கமென்ஸ்மெண்ட் ஆஃப் கேபிட்டலைசேஷன் கமென்ஸ்மெண்ட் ஆஃப் கேபிட்டலைசேஷன் சஸ்பென்ஷன் ஆஃப் கேபிட்டலைசேஷன் செசேஷன் ஆஃப் கேபிட்டலைசேஷன் கமென்ஸ்மெண்ட் suspension cessation from when you should capitalize is what we learn as commencement from when I mean from when you should stop capitalization is cessation and when you should temporarily stop the capitalization is suspension understood so from when you should start commencement when you should end cessation temporary stoppage stop then after some time please continue again understood that is what we call it as suspension temporarily suspending the class for half an hour abina pichu koduva like that if it is continue presently stopped after some time we are going to start understood so thereby we have commencement suspension cessation everybody from when capitalization should commence capitalization will commence once expenditure on qualifying asset incurred and borrowing cost was incurred and activities on qualifying asset was commenced or in progress expenditure on qualifying asset incurred borrowing cost incurred activities on qualifying asset was commenced so only if all these three condition cumulatively satisfied you can start capitalizing what interest borrowing cost understood which means I took loan that alone not sufficient I have spent that money number 1 you should have incurred what borrowing cost if there is a moratorium period and you are saving some interest absolutely there is you can't capitalize something which is not incurred you should have incurred borrowing cost activities on qualifying asset should have been commenced so what which means what now so spend expenditure main means activities commenced so not necessary sometime you would have paid simply advance we have paid some for construction of a building worth rupees 1 crore we paid some advance to a engineer for making a plan and we have so far not met him also we have just paid one advance we have just fixed an appointment 1 month later so for meeting him only we have to pay some advance understood we have incurred expenditure borrowing cost incurred but no activities was commenced understood in that case also you can't capitalize so all conditions should be cumulatively satisfied to capitalize borrowing cost should have been incurred expenditure should have been incurred activity should have been commenced cessation capitalization shall be ceased when the asset is substantially ready for its intended use capitalization shall be ceased when the asset is substantially ready for its intended use so can we capitalize the borrowing cost relating to inventories stock in trade we borrowed money and interest can be capitalized to stock in trade yes if the stock in trade is qualifying asset so here it is not differentiating as fixed asset or Current asset or stock in trade. Even for stock in trade, in AS2, it has been mentioned very clearly that interest cost shall not be capitalized. I mean, interest cost is not forming part of cost of the inventories. But it is also mentioning a point unless qualified as per AS16. Understood? Which means, please understand that. So, interest can be capitalized even for the inventories also. Are you following? So, in fact, institute is giving an example which most of you must be liking, that it is for wines and spirits. So, these wines and all take long time, understood, for it's ready for sale. Understood, from the process, and takes long time for its saleable condition. Understood, it has to be stored someplace and for long time, only then you get the effect of wine or spirit, whatever be the case. Correct? So, whatever interest that has been incurred can be added to the cost of inventories. Everybody, it could be applicable to automobile industry. Whenever an asset takes from the starting of production till it is converted into finished goods which is ready for sale, whatever interest can also be added to cost of, so which means building, I am holding it as stock in trade, can I add the interest to the cost of such building? Please respond. Building which I am having as stock in trade, can I add? Provided it is ready for till it is ready for sale. Understood? Now listen carefully. When this provision is there, in fact, as an auditor, you should be very strictly following this issue for this real estate sectors or builders. What most of the builders will do, they would have constructed, they would have completed all the formalities. 90% of construction work is over. In fact, 95% work will be over. Respond. And these construction now would have been made by taking huge loans. They will keep on paying interest. And what these builders will do, all such interest will be added to building till the building is getting sold. Only they, when they book the revenue, they will book the cost in P&L. Correct? Actually, whether revenue is arising or not, they should have booked this interest because the building was already ready for sale. But they will, what they will do is that some small touch up of painting, some small works, they will keep it pending, and they will do it only after receiving advance from the buyer. But this standard says that when the asset is substantially ready for its intended use, you should have stopped what? Capitalization. After that, there is no point of capitalization. It shall be charged to P&L. Understood? Anyway, that should be strictly followed, but many times we close our eyes in such application. So, a serious provision, it is not till it is sold or till it is ready, it is used, it is substantially ready for use. And we have to give that stress to when it is ready for use, not till it is actually used or till not it is actually sold. Understanding? So it is substantially ready for its intended use. That is what the point there. Understood? Cessation. Capitalization should be stopped. Even though you are keep on paying interest, you can't capitalize after that. You should be charging to P&L. Everybody? Everybody? Okay. Some of them have gone into full sleep mode, half sleep mode. Please wake up, sir. You have lots of time. One more hour is there. AC. Okay, AC. Suspension. Say, what is suspension means? What we told? You are paying interest, work is on progress, you keep on adding the interest to the asset. Respond.
Yes, sir.
Suddenly, you stop capitalization even though you are paying interest. Which means during such time, what you should do? Capitalization suspended. Which means during such time, what you should do? Borrowing cost will be expense. Whenever it is not capitalized, borrowing cost shall be expense. So when it shall be suspended, so when the active development of the qualifying asset is interrupted, then capitalization is suspended during the period of interruption. Understood? Please. If the active development of the qualifying asset is interrupted, if the active development of the qualifying asset is interrupted. If the active development of the qualifying asset is interrupted, then capitalization will be suspended during the period of interruption. if the active development of the qualifying asset is interrupted. Suddenly there is no development, no work is happening, stand still it is there, understood? In that case, during the period of interruption, you should stop the capitalization, suspend the capitalization, which means it is not once for all stop, after which again you can restart the capitalization, understood? So if the active development of qualifying asset is interrupted, then capitalization will be suspended during the period of interruption, understood? Okay. Exception to suspension. What is exception to suspension? Even though there is interruption, capitalization will not be suspended. That is what exception to suspension. If the interruption forms part of overall plan, if the interruption forms part of overall plan, if the interruption forms part of overall plan or necessary for the asset or necessary for the development of the asset then capitalization will not be suspended. So we are constructing, there is a builder constructing a building and the project is going to take around 3 years time. How many years?
3 years.
Now suddenly the 8 months in the construction progress, he started capitalizing the interest. 2 months suddenly no work is happening. Everybody. It was actually rainy season. And two months no work is happening, but the 2 months are already covered in the project. It is already subject to the overall plan. In the 2 months no work only happening, understood? No development is happening. Could you appreciate that? So it's an interruption. Respond. Though it is interruption, it is actually forming part of the overall plan. I know that during rainy time we can't work, do the work, understood? In that time, whatever interest that you pay should be capitalized or suspended?
Capitalized.
Understood? See, suddenly during 2 months there was no work because the project has been stayed by the court. Everybody, the project, it is not because of rainy season and all. 2 months no work or 3-4 months no work because the project has been stayed by the court, or maybe some